بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com, your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed Explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
The third section is regarding the position of the Muslim nation and the path of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah in replying on the innovators and refuting the innovators. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah are still on the path of replying on the innovators and denying all their falsehood. This, of course, this is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has ordered his nation to be aware of innovators. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as narrated in Sahih Muslim, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ آوَى مُحْدِثًا. The curse of Allah be upon those who give shelter to an innovator. مُحْدِثًا here actually means someone who initiates a crime and wants to hide from being punished. But also it means an innovator, because muhdatha in Arabic means innovation. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said, man waqqara sahiba bid'ah faqad a'ana ala hadm al-islam. This is a quotation that is narrated by one of the Tabi'is, but it is also narrated about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sheikh Al-Albani says it is a hasan narration, a good narration, which means he who gives respect to an innovator, then he is supporting in destroying Islam. من وقر صاحب بدعة فقد أعان على هدم الإسلام. He who gives any form of support to an innovator, then he is actually supporting destruction of Islam. That is because Islam is composed of one sunnah plus another sunnah plus another sunnah. So if you support innovators, that means this will be on the expense of sunnahs. And by wiping out those sunnahs, you have wiped out Islam and you have destroyed Islam. Now, we mentioned earlier the example of Ibn Abbas when he was blind and old, how he reacted to an innovation. Also, Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhuma, when he heard about those same people, he shouted in the masjid saying that those people are acting against the true hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding the belief in the Qadr. And then he said, by Allah, if they don't believe in this, they will go to hellfire. And then he said, inform them if you see them that I have nothing to do with them and they have nothing to do with me. So this is something which shows the strong position of the companions. Also, the Sheikh here quotes Umm al-Darda radiallahu anha, one of the companions, one of the women. She said, my husband Abu Darda came in very angrily. So I said, what's wrong with you? He said, by Allah, I know nothing that I see from those people, except that they pray together, except that they make prayers in congregation. Narrated by Bukhari. In other words, Abu Darda رضي الله عنه saw some people that were acting different from the Sunnah in so many ways that led him to say this strong statement that they have nothing from the religion of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم except the congregation prayer, which shows how the companions got angry when they saw innovations. Also, the narration about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه in the Masjid of Kufa, when he was informed by another companion, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari رضي الله عنه, about groups and circles in the Masjid making dhikr, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, in a way which was different than what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has taught the companions. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه acted very strongly, and he came to them and he said to them, what you are doing now is either something which you think it is better than the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or something which is an innovation. Of course, they had nothing to say, but we meant good. Our intention is good. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, there are so many who mean good but do not achieve it. This is a very important statement that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is making, because it is not enough for you to mean good to be rewarded. You have to mean good and act good. If you mean good and act good, then you will be rewarded. But if you only mean good and do not act good, you will not be rewarded. And if you act good but you don't mean good by it, then again you will not be rewarded. So we have two conditions: the sincerity of the heart and the goodness of the action. To follow the Sunnah, that is the goodness. To follow the Sharia, to follow the legislation. You cannot make up something from your mind thinking that it is good and it will please Allah, because by this you are saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has betrayed Allah. He did not inform his nation everything which brings them close to Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left no room for anyone else to come and introduce something good after him. He said, by Allah, there is nothing good except that I told you to do, and there is nothing evil except that I have warned you against. So how could someone else come after him and say, here I have something good to do, other than what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has come with? This is a blasphemy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud told them this, and those people who were doing this innovation, later on they became strong innovators. They became the Khawarij, the ones who declared the companions to be kafirs, the ones who fought with Ali radiallahu anhu and fought with the companions and eventually killed Ali radiallahu anhu. They were the Khawarij. Their start was here in Kufa, when they were making dhikr in circles, and they started that innovation, and later on they became strong innovators because they left the companions. Another example the Sheikh gives, that a man came to Imam Malik rahimahullah, and he asked Imam Malik, where should I start my ihram for Hajj or Umrah? Imam Malik said, from the miqat, the position that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has assigned for you to start your Hajj from. The man said, how about if I start my ihram before that, before the miqat? So Imam Malik said, no, I don't see that to be right. So the man said, what's so bad about it? What makes you hate this? The Imam Malik said, what's bad about it is the fitna. That is the result of acting different from the Sunnah. أكره عليك الفتنة, he said. That's what I hate for you, is the result of acting different than the sunnah is the fitna. As Allah said, فليحذر الذين يخالفون عن أمره أن تصيبهم فتنة أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم. Let those who act different from his order, from his sunnah, be aware of two evils. One of them, the first is the fitna, the affliction of the heart, the twist of the heart, which is a very bad result. So the man said, what fitna could be in doing more good? Subhanallah. So Imam Malik told him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. And he mentioned this verse. Let those who act different from his order be aware of two evils. And what is a greater fitna than thinking that you were privileged by a virtue of an action that the Prophet ﷺ was not privileged with? Yani by thinking it's okay to do that and thinking that you are rewarded for that and you will be privileged. This is like thinking that you have been privileged with something that the Prophet ﷺ has not been privileged. What a greater fitna could be than this? Yani the innovation, even though it looks small, starts small, yani the danger about it is that if you follow this path of innovations, you will wind up with great innovations. Those who have fallen into great innovations, they started with small innovations. So they accepted the concept of innovation, and therefore Shaitan led them step by step to a destruction. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان. Do not follow the footsteps of Shaitan. Shaitan takes you step by step. He knows you. He knows you are a person who fear Allah and you want to please Allah and all that. So he cannot come and tell you commit kufr directly or do this big thing. No, you will not do it. He'll come and make something look very good to you or beautiful, and he whispers to you to do it. And then build on that until he reaches what he wants. This is the way of Shaitan. Then the Shaykh says, the way of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah regarding replying the people of innovation is based on the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It is to follow the proofs from Quran and Sunnah to destroy all the falsehood of the innovators. And they have written so many books as replies and refutations of the innovators, especially in matters of aqidah. They replied on Shi'as, Khawarij, Jahmiya, Mu'tazila, Asha'ira, all those people. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, for example, wrote a book called Ar-Raddu ala al-Jahmiya, the reply on the Jahmis. Uthman ibn Sa'id al-Darami also wrote Ar-Raddu ala al-Jahmiya. Imam al-Bukhari in some of his books wrote the same thing. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah devoted most of his writings in replying on the innovators. He has, for example, Ar-Radd ala al-Mantiqiyyin, Ar-Radd ala al-Falasifa, reply on the philosophers, the reply on those who follow logic or something like that. He has Dar' Ta'arud al-Aql wa al-Naql, 11 volumes, a reply on Ash'ariyas and Mu'tazilas. He has Minhaj al-Sunnah, about 7 or 8 volumes, a reply on Shi'as, and also on Asha'ira and Khawarij and others. The book of I'tisam by Ash-Shatibi, a great book. The book of Iqtida' al-Sirat al-Mustaqim by Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. The book of Inkar al-Hawadith wal-Bid'ah, reply on the innovations by Ibn Waddah al-Qurtubi. The book of Al-Hawadith wal-Bid'ah, again by الطرطوشي, the book الباعث على إنكار البدع والحوادث by أبو شامة, and amongst the contemporary books you have the book of إبداع في مضار الابتداع. This is also showing the dangers of innovators and innovations and replying on them by Sheikh Ali Mahfouz. The book of Sunan and al-Mubtada'at by al-Shuqayri. The book of al-Tahdhir min al-Bid'ah by Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz. Then the Sheikh says, the Muslim scholars, by the grace of Allah, keep on this path of replying on the innovators and denying their innovations and exposing them in the magazines, in the radio stations, and by every mean they can. The Sheikh himself, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, has many replies. He has a reply on Al-Buti. He has replies on a lot of Quburis. He has replies on many contemporary writers. Every now and then he puts an article replying on innovators. And in regards to the toughness with innovators, of course, this was the way of the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, since they were able to do that. The Sunnah was strong and the rulership was in their hand. And when they were strong on the innovators, this would not backlash and it would not cause more disadvantages than advantages. But in a situation where the Sunnis are not in authority and they are weak compared to the rest of the people, then the situation might change. And you cannot show toughness like you show when the Sunnah is strong. If you show toughness, you might hurt the Muslims, the rest of the Muslims and the rest of the Sunnis. You might cause chaos to the Sunnis. You might cause destruction to the Sunnis. So in this case, one should put in mind the advantages and disadvantages of showing the toughness. As a matter of fact, sometimes the Sunni has to show leniency just to save the Sunnis and not to make them subject to the disadvantages. This is the right path of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This has been shown by Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan in many of his fatwas regarding the innovators. In one fatwa, he said that we have some people who do not consider this great fundamental of Islam, and that is to weigh the advantages and disadvantages. And therefore, a lot of corruption could occur as a result of abandoning the innovations. And also, all other scholars, if you go to the internet, to the Sheikh bin Baz's replies on the innovators, you will see how his path is. Sometimes he talks to someone who is known to be not only an innovator, but his innovations are kufr, which takes someone out of Islam. But you find the reply of Sheikh bin Baz on him is full with gentleness, because this person who is an innovator is a big authority, and to be hard on him, it will backlash and it will bring more disadvantages to the Sunnis and to the Salafis, not only the ones who are in his country, but others also. So the Sheikh points out to his mistakes gently, and he speaks to him gently, and he shows respect in speech to him, like saying, Fadilatu Sheikh, such and such. Sheikh bin Baz says, Fadilatu Sheikh, this and that, to someone whose innovations are kufr. So this is not something which the Sheikh is doing opposite to Quran and Sunnah, but this is exactly what Quran and Sunnah show us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his time, in the beginning, he showed gentleness to people who were kafir in their hearts, like Abdullah ibn Abi Salul, the head of the hypocrites, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam found it great disadvantage to show toughness on him. That would cause people outside the Muslim community to think that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was unjust to his companions. So he felt the disadvantages. That's why he was gentle in dealing with their statements, the hypocrites' statements. Yani, the hypocrite's statement was kufr, and the Prophet ﷺ dealt with it gently. هذا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد.